part of it. I don't feel special because I'm here. I just feel like this thing that I wish didn't matter as much as it does to other people. I mean, I would love to live in a society where being gay was no more interesting or important than anyone else than the color of my eyes or my shoe size. We don't. In my lifetime, we might be there. That'd be awesome, where all of us who do feel like we are marginalized wouldn't be marginalized because the margins disappear. But, you know, I don't have, and that's part of the fun of acting, to really give them a chance to kind of get out of your own skin and realize that, for me, that's what acting is I was attracted to the art when I was young because I wanted to be anybody else. It might be very much, you know, what else did either I fought, and so I, you know, I just, oh, just give me a role. Give me someone else's, you know, costume to wear, because I don't want to be mine. It's hiding, it was me hiding. And then as you learn the craft and you do it for years, I've learned that, oh, it's just me. I've never ever been anything but me on stage or on screen before. And it's always been me. Oh, it's going to be me. It's me all along.
Oh, they're my fault.
It's kind of similar to, if I can speak on that just for a second. I mean, in the same way that if an actor is on stage, if a straight actor is on stage playing opposite someone of the opposite gender, and their character is madly in love with this person, let's say, Ryan Murray, madly in love with this woman. Sure, he's straight, but if, let's say, like, she's just not as tight or whatever, like, he only likes blonde girls and she's brunette. It's a similar thing. He has to, like, feel the attraction for her, even though she's not his type. In the same way a gay actor can exercise the same acting ability for someone of the gender that's not who they're attracted to. You don't have to be attracted to someone to be attracted to them in a scene. You know? So it's the same thing.
In the same sense that I don't have to have lost my father to play Hamlet. You know, that's the great thing about acting, is you can put yourself in these experiences without actually experiencing them. So you get an idea of what that person's perspective might be on life, but without having to go through all the horrible things they go through. That's the appeal of acting, is the multitude of perspectives you cultivate without having to agonize.
I think it makes you more accepting when you're too, because you have to put yourself in the shoes of all these people that you don't have an understanding of. And so when you act, you see things from other people's perspectives, and you start accepting them. Which I think is why theater is so accepting. You see a lot of LGBT individuals in the arts.
Yeah, I think it's true.
It's not really a question, but earlier you guys were talking about the fear of failure. Well, my life has been full of nothing but failures. Honestly, at this point, I kind of expect to fail. But I know my life is a mess. I'm weird, I'm a nerd, I'm crazy, and I am proud. I am not ashamed of who I am, and if you can't accept that, there's the door, get out.
So the company I work with for my day job, the chief operational officer, whatever, is so wonderful, I think, to me, because his motto is, well, the only way we're going to get better is to try things, and we're going to fail. So he embraces the idea of, we want to fail. We want to fail on different things and learn from every failure that we experience, but we want to fail constantly, over and over and over, and iterate and iterate and iterate, because that's how we change. In the same way, I think, as humans, when we try something and we fail, we objectively say, That's an experience that helps make you who you are. So for me, I lived in Tokyo for 13 months. And you're like, that's amazing. You're such an amazing person. How did you do that? You're so incredible. You must be perfect. Oh, no. So I studied Japanese in college. And I'm going to do with this completely and utterly useless degree that I have. And I decided I wanted to be a translator. And I was going to make a goal. I'm going to live in Japan, it's going to be great, it's going to be the best thing ever. I'm going to Tokyo, my cool Japanese apartment. I lived in Akihabara, by the way. Wow, that's amazing, you must be awesome. And so I went to a tech company just west of Akihabara, And I went and I was like, oh, yes, I'm doing it. I got the work visa, I got the sponsorship, I live here now. Whatever, I was so miserable. I was really miserable for a variety of reasons. I'm not trying to say like, oh, if you live in Japan, you will not be happy. I was putting my own, like, this is what it will be like in my head. And I went, and I'm a certain level of Japanese, but regardless of how much Japanese you study, when you get into like a Japanese work environment, and you sit down for that first work meeting, and suddenly they're saying all these words that you've maybe read once, if you're lucky, you're like, oh, first quarter profit margin, blah, blah, blah. Like, oh, what's that word? Oh, I'm so out of my own depth right now. And objectively, I sat there and I was like, I'm failing right now. I just failed. My Japanese is not good enough to do what I came here to do. Oh my gosh, why am I here? My life is a lie right now. What am I doing?
It's a different thing when you get to the motherland.
yeah, it is. But in a similar way, like, I could have seen it one of two ways. I got there and I had a choice to make. I could have thought, like, I failed. I didn't do what I was supposed to do. I can't do this. But I stayed. I stayed for 13 months. My Japanese got better. It was really hard. I'm still not perfect. You know, I can interpret, but
it's perfect.
Exactly. Exactly. That's the thing.
Who wants perfect? Perfect people are boring. Have you met a perfect person?
So
but I came back. After 13 months, I was like, okay, not the best time. I came here and I did what I came to do. So I came back, and there are two ways to think about it. I could either say, like, wow, I wasted so much time. I failed. Or I can say, I had a really interesting experience. I learned a lot of things. And because of that, like, no one else in the world has the configuration of things that I did. And even though I can feel like, wow, that was horrible, I messed up big time, and wasted this amount of time in my life, it gave me experiences. And that's true for everyone, no matter what you have done, no matter what you have failed at, because you did that, no one else has done that. Like, that like collection of things that you have done and maybe you failed at. So what? Who cares? Because it makes you interesting.
And I would argue it makes you more valuable to other people, because, I mean, if you're... Has everyone seen that sort of Black Mirror with the social media thing where you're waiting the wedding?
Yeah.
The character, the truck driver that she meets.
Yeah.
That's the greatest character in the entire show, is that one character, because she's lost everything and she just said, I don't care anymore. And she's the one person that you feel like, man, I could just talk to her and be who I am around this person. Like, she doesn't want anything from me, she just wants me to be real. People that put themselves in situations, or lose, you know, situations that we spend, that we fret and spend most of our lives trying to avoid, those people are the ones that make you comfortable. Those are the people that are like, you know, I mean, like, because I've been picked on, because I've failed, because I've embarrassed myself on numerous occasions, because I've nearly died, both psychologically and physically, I'm in a position to just be kind of like, oh, it's cute. I know what you're feeling right now. I've been there. Don't worry. It's going to be all right. It's going to get better. Like, that makes that so much more useful to other people. We all need that. No, if I'm afraid of flying, I want to sit next to someone that got over the fear of flying and then kind of hold my hand with the turbulence, be like, oh, I know what you're feeling, but yeah, it's going to be all right. I don't want to sit next to the person who's like, why are you afraid? That's stupid. Because they've never experienced it, you know? I don't want to. So failing, like we said earlier about like being that person that goes through and like messes things up, that's awesome, but I argue that makes you more valuable. Because all of us, that's what we fear. We fear messing up. So to be the sort of person that's been down that road and can look at someone else who's afraid of it and be like, oh, I know how you're feeling, but I promise you it's not as bad as you think.
Yeah.
Like, that's amazing. Getting everything right all the time is perfection. Perfection. People who are perfect are people that do everything right. Man, I don't want that.
But you know what, who are weird, honestly, I just say people who are weird just have big personalities.
Weird is awesome. Everyone's weird. Everyone's weird.
Yes.
Everyone's weird. Sports nerds are weird. In exactly the same way we're all weird. Like, I can talk about Doctor Who for hours and Shakespeare for hours, and they can talk about basketball and be like, you're weird. They're like, oh, we're the same person. They just like basketball. Just put that energy.
I can talk about Lord of the Rings and anime and video games for hours on end.
That's awesome. You had a question there in your glasses.
Yes. And this is kind of a question and a statement for everybody. I think social media has perpetuated that outing process for all of constantly finding that out in myself, regardless of me being gay, it's, oh, you like one of so sorry, or you like one of oh my gosh, and you have MS, Jesus Christ. So that speaks to his situation. Do you find that social media is prolonging this outing process? Because people keep discovering you and like, oh, she's this way, or she likes that, and oh my God. What do you think about that?
I have to think about that, because I have a very troubled relationship with the idea of social media. Part of me hates it. And as an idea, it's beautiful, because it puts you in touch with people you may not ever meet otherwise, and it's
like, I don't use social media.
But social media can be really dangerous, because, I mean, it's also, it's impression management taken to the nth degree. It's people, you know, going, well, I need to be this to get likes. Because you get addicted, and I know, I mean, it's not a generational thing either. It's everyone has probably a lot of access to it, no matter how old you are. Like, my mother was like, hey, what's the Facebook? But, I mean, it's difficult, because there's a lot of, I was thinking about this a few years ago online bullying was first kind of, we were having a dialogue about it as a culture, and I realized, like, there used to be, like, when I was a kid, you know, if I was picked on in school, at least it was only a block of my day. It was, you know, 3 o'clock, I could go home and not be around it anymore. Like, the people that I was being picked on weren't around, and I'd go home, hang out with my friends. But now, like, social media or online, the bullying is coming from there. It's with you 24/7, you know, unless you can turn it off, and there's no intention. Because you feel like, well, that's why I get in touch with the people that I like, and you want to do these things, and it can become an addiction, and it can replace actual questions about social interactions, which I feel much more common, because they're in real time, and you have to, you know, actually talk to someone and risk saying the wrong thing or